You think you know me?
Gentlemen, how are you?
Oh, very good.
Move your mics up where you want.
You know, if you just crouch over, if you go straight, however you do it. There you go. You guys are good. All right, folks. Today I tortured this family for a few years, their mother at least, and she would laugh every time I said, let's come in and talk plants. Nope, no, never going to happen. But unfortunately, Mikey the other day stopped. So here we are. I got the Calabrese boys. How do you spell Calabrese?
C-A-L-A-B-R-E-S-E.
I get it wrong every time. I do.
That's as long as you get it close.
Close, right. So, age?
41.
Wow, that old.
Yeah, getting there. 39. Yeah.
39. Wonderful. Oh, we got to, here we go. We're going to go like this. Now you can speak. Try it. Hi. How are you?
Hi.
Hey. Oh, yeah. Big difference.
You hear me better?
Yeah, great. All right, so these are the Calabrese boys. They grew up across from me, farming all your life?
Yeah, basically since I could walk, I guess.
Right. Did you go to school here? You mentioned you did a drive-by at Westfield.
Yeah. I was here for a few short months and then went back to Southwick High.
All right, so you're both Southwick High guys.
Yeah, that's correct.
Nice. And when I first met you, realistically, I had heard you guys dabbled in snowmobiles back in the day in high school, right? What did you do? Rumor was that your grandfather bought a machine to make snow. Did that actually happen?
Yeah,
we had a.
It did.
Well, we were racing snowcross like around the whole New England area, and we didn't get snow here to test, so we actually made our own snow guns and pumped water out of the irrigation.
Right, pump. You had the ponds.
We had the irrigation pumps, so we had enough pressure with those. So we used the irrigation pumps, and we rented a compressor, and
away you went.
Made one big pile. So
jeez, we could have had tubing over there. So much money we could have made.
Yeah, until he added up the fuel prices all night of running the pumps, and then
that was it, Gramps.
Yeah, we had a small pile after that.
Wonderful. All right, so you both work on the farm?
Yes.
Yes.
Every day?
Every day.
Every day.
Winter's off. You guys go to Florida in the winter?
Yeah, I went to Florida for a while this winter, and then
but not much.
Like a couple weeks, and then a lot of time I spend out west because I still ride snowmobiles for a few manufacturing companies. And
nice.
So the team's based out of Colorado. So I stay like out there a lot in the wintertime.
Right. So Mikey has to run the show.
Yeah. Me and my dad do most of the maintenance and all the repairs throughout the winter. You know, we fix all the equipment, oil changes, greenhouse heaters, everything, getting ready for the next season.
So you're a seed. Like, educate me. You guys don't buy product that's already done. You tomato plants, all that. You're
100%. We start.
When do you start? Seeds. Yeah.
Usually January 1st. So we start the first greenhouse.
So you get off from Thanksgiving to January.
It's 1st. Usually about Thanksgiving to Christmas. The slow time.
But it's not like full on like it is now when 12-14 hour days and the winter time is a couple hours in the greenhouse.
Yeah.
Of seeding the seedlings that are going to go for early season stuff and like that and. It's not full on like it is now.
No, absolutely.
It's usually pretty busy up to like about 2 weeks before Easter. But Easter was so early this year.
It is.
That it threw everything off.
Right.
So we didn't really, we didn't do Easter flowers.
In the anything. Big scheme of things, I think that's a placeholder, you know.
It is. It's just to get people, let people know we're open again. Here we go. Yeah.
I don't see Easter being like it used to be flower-wise.
No, they don't want the early pansies and stuff. It's more, everyone, if they're going to spend the money, they want full on, their flower beds done with their petunias and
everything,
marigolds and all that stuff.
Did you ever think you'd know that much about flowers? You guys don't look like you'd know that much about flowers.
I honestly really don't.
No. And agreed, right?
You pick it up.
You pick it up. I never thought I'd make ice cream, but you pick it up.
Yep.
You just
do it. They call it a jack of all trades, master of none, right?
Master of none.
Yep.
How many acres do you guys farm?
It varies from year to year, depending on how much I lease from other landowners in town and what we have, pre-sold or, kind of contracted with our main suppliers.
Sure.
And depending on, the commodities market, we'll grow some, commodities like that, too.
Isn't that crazy? Here we are in Southwick, and you guys are looking at a commodities market. No, but seriously, all out west. I mean,
it's the same thing as out west. It's just on a smaller scale.
Literally.
Instead of having a 36-row planter, you got a 12-row planter or a 6-row planter.
Right.
So, I mean, it's all the same. You still need the same combine to pick it, but.
It's crazy. Yeah.
It's just, you're only limited to how many acres you can because there's only so many around, too. That's the problem. Like, If I was out in Ohio or something, you could be growing 10, 15,000 acres.
A couple years ago, you were playing with probably corn pretty heavy, weren't you, at one time? And it was, yeah, you guys were all over New England, it seemed.
Yeah, but I was farming, like, basically from Albany, New York to Cape Cod.
Yeah,
jeez. So, there's a lot of nights of no sleep and on the road moving equipment from one farm to get it to the next farm. And then during harvest, it's such a timely thing that has to be picked when the weather's good. So you could get done at 11:30 at night somewhere and like, all right, we got to go move to the next farm. And, you know, next thing you know, you're driving 50 miles down to the next place, wherever I started from.
Because you chase the moisture content of the corn. That's when you pick it.
Literally.
So if it's too wet or too dry, you go to the next field and you find the right one, and then you just keep going back and forth unless you got a grain dryer and all that stuff. So you pick the corn wet and then dry it, but that's we tried doing that too. It's just a lot to take on because we do mostly vegetables.
Correct.
And flowers and the greenhouses and stuff. And it's just, I mean, it's hard to have too many fires in the pot.
And you learn that, don't you? You know, at first, in your younger days, no, we can do the world, and then it just doesn't add up anymore.
I enjoy sleeping a little bit now.
Do you?
More than I did back then.
Yeah, imagine that. And you're at the point. We work at a ski lodge in the winter, right? I can tell you, in the last 6-7 years, weather has changed.
Absolutely.
You know.
Yeah.
And for my end in the winter, in last year, it looked like it rained every weekend. How does it affect you guys?
The weather, I mean, plays the biggest factor on timing when I'm going to start, you know, into the field work. And, like, it was almost deceiving back in middle of March this year. We were in 70-degree weather.
Right.
And it was like, all right, should we go? But then, you know, just by history of going on, it's no sense in rushing it when I can still get it in on my timely, like, schedule where it's going to come in when I need it anyway. So why take the risk? Because there's so much input cost into all that stuff.
Yeah.
If you go out there and planted 30 acres of sweet corn and we got snow or we went down into 18 degrees, 20 degrees back in the beginning of April, it would have just been a disaster and been redoing it anyway. So the weather plays a factor, but it's also a schedule that, you know, we've developed over the years where if we know we put it on this date, I can get it on this time. So there's no sense in rushing it right at this point.
Right, and you don't want it all at the same time. That doesn't work, especially your corn, right? You guys got to layer that out
for
X amount of weeks to harvest.
That's like staggered, almost on like a 10-day rotation. So we plant, and we just figure that we're going to be picking for 10 days on that farm. So you want to have the next one ready to go on the 10th day when you're done with that one.
And a perfect example of that is last year's peach crop. So last year, I mean, every year we do about 12 acres of peach trees, about 12 acres of apples.
And was that a high school rumors, again.
I'll get to that. Okay. It started out, what happened was last year it got real warm, like February.
It did. It
got up to like 70 degrees. So all the peaches, they all blossomed. And then a week later it got down to like -1, 10 degrees. So all the blossoms froze and that just killed the whole peach crop for last year. And I mean, that's a pretty big hit. People come here just to buy our peaches.
Your peaches go in my ice cream.
Everything.
No, literally.
I know, I know. Yeah, it's like the stray and the strawberries and all that stuff.
Oh, I love the strawberries. Yeah,
we're very good. So, I mean, it was took a hit. But this year, it was getting close. It was like 31 for an hour or two at night, and we made it. So it looks beautiful.
It does.
Absolutely. So, yeah, that actually started. It's funny. It started as a college project for my dad. He went to UMass. So as his thesis or something, he started the peach trees, and he put in an acre. And we had a lot of land that was hilly and rocky, so you couldn't plant on it.
Welcome
so
he figured he'd
put something else on it.
Right.
So, I mean, he put peach trees and then apples and plums and cherries and all that. And then as it progressed, it got to the point where we are today.
Wow. So that was all the old man. See the rumors. I knew someone planted it.
Yeah. He planted it. We maintain it.
Yeah, which is fine. Yep. Nothing wrong with that. How long have you been? So Grandpa bought the farm? Or was it a farm when Grandpa bought it?
Yeah, that was the second piece. He actually started in Agawam.
Well, all Kyler Breeses start in Agawam. That's
Yeah, he was raising pigs in Agawam, and he was kind of in a neighborhood, so they weren't too fond upon it. Huh. And then he ended up moving over to Southwick and buying where our roadside stand is now is where he had his original, like, cart almost.
Okay. And there's a picture of it inside the store, I believe. Yeah.
Yeah. That's where he started. And then, I mean, he bought that original piece and we extended over the years and own a couple other farms on the other side of the like South Long Yard over yes. there, and that's our home farm. And
right,
this is all when he came out of the Navy. So first he was a
Navy guy.
Then he went to the Navy, and then when he got out from his tour, he came back and he went to work. So like everybody did back then.
Yeah.
So I mean, he bought the farm. My grandmother grew flowers. He did the vegetables, and he just progressed from a wagon, from a 12 by 4 wagon cart by the side of the road to where we are today.
That is something.
Yeah.
And he even raised pigs till he was in his 90s.
Well, I remember that. Yeah. Yeah, literally. Yeah.
At one point, I think we used to have a couple hundred pigs. He had feeder pigs and the sows and everything, and that was like that was his hobby.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, I can remember when I opened up at the dairy, he would come and get strawberry was his flavor. He'd sit under we had a tent for a seating area. He'd sit there. Yep. And then when we bought Barb's Bait, he educated me very quickly. I'd never have two driveways. to understand that right away. And my uncle sells flowers, or he did, Artie Ram. You guys know Artie.
Yep.
So that was like the second question. So, kid, are you selling flowers? And I'm like, Joe, are you selling ice cream? No. And I'm not selling flowers.
You told him you were selling flowers. You probably
wouldn't some of that be here today. And he was... He wasn't rough, but he was rough. But once you knew him, oh my God, the guy was butter.
You were always going to know how he felt.
always. And he would
whether you wanted to hear it or not.
And he would always let me know how bad my employees were mowing the lawn. Whatever was being done in front of my property that you guys could see, I heard all about it.
That's it.
Every couple of days, he'd show up and
got to keep up the image.
Oh yeah, but just that kid's really stupid on your mower. You know that? Yeah, I'm aware of my repair bills. Yeah, someone's stupid on my mower. You know?
How do you think we felt? He would drive around the fields and come back and give us his opinion about that.
Literally, right? You grew up with torture of your own man and your grandfather. No doubt about it.
Yeah, but he learned how to do it right.
You did. You really did. Right. And now, without question, you both. I never see you two together. You know what I mean? You guys are just two different parts of the operation of the farm.
Yeah, I'm like out, doing all the field work and planting and maintaining the crops. He's in the yard there.
He's in the yard. He's got about 37 pieces of equipment broken that you probably broke. And
I do all the maintenance.
You
the repairs, all the welding, all that stuff. I do all the irrigation, and I take care of the fruit trees. And he does pretty much everything else. He does all the harrowing, the planting, the crops, seeding, the fertilizing. So he does pretty good with it.
He does.
Yeah.
How expensive. You're going to be half a doctor to go assess the plants, what's wrong with them.
Literally.
And the weather, that's a huge part. I mean, too much rain, you're getting molds and stuff in the field, or too dry, you're starting to stress the plant out where you're not going to produce. So there's got to be a happy medium all the time.
All the time.
All that stuff. I mean, if we're not producing crops, we're not surviving. So.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
How many employees, roughly?
That varies from season to season. But
you can have like 8 or 10 in the store.
Yeah, and then, I see that. And then the fields are the fields, 10, right?
10, 15. I mean, at one point, maybe 25 for a week or two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Always hard to do.
But it's the busy time. The busy time is usually from July and August, but we started doing a lot more pumpkins.
Yeah.
So we're doing really big into the fall stuff. So now our busy season kind of real well. It's still busy in July and August, but September and October – all the way up to Halloween is super, super busy. We probably did about 30 acres of pumpkins last year.
And that's just as bad, right? Because I remember one year it got too wet, and you guys lost half of it.
Last year was a really wet year, and we were fortunate enough to some of the techniques that I'm using now, we actually did get a decent crop on one farm, which was a saving grace because another one was completely underwater. So we got half of it. That's why it ended up being only about 30 acres, but they yielded really well. So we still salvaged the pumpkin season, at least for our area.
Sure.
Yeah, because a lot of guys up north in the valley took a hit with all that.
They
did. River flooded. And
They got flooded out back in, I think it was July. I mean, I know a lot of guys up there that their crops were a complete disaster. And once the water comes over a plant like that, it's actually, you can't even harvest it technically because of the bacteria from the river and everything.
You got to destroy it.
They had to destroy thousands of acres up there last year.
Literally,
potatoes, everything. Even if it was in the ground, everything.
So I noticed in the there's a lot happening at your place from 5:30 in the morning to probably before you open. A lot of wholesale? Is that what I see?
Yeah, I mean.
Local farms seem to.
Yes, we.
You guys seem to have most of the product in
the area. We have. We do a lot. I mean, the retail stands there.
Right.
And that's really good income for us. But the wholesale is the majority of the business. I mean, we supply a lot of chain stores. Like you said, smaller roadside stands come over.
About 3 o'clock, Mikey leaves in a box truck every day.
Yeah.
Right?
That's, usually go to Big Y around there, make my rounds, go to Hartford.
Literally.
Almost. Go up to Hatfield. There's about 5 or 6 big places we go all the time and stuff like that.
And it's a run every couple of days. That's it.
Yep. Go, every day. It's pretty much the same, you know, from July to, like I said, about Halloween. I'm trucking the same thing every day. It's the same route pretty much all week long, 7 days a week. And then in the fall, it's trucking commodities, corn, beans, stuff like that out to New York.
Amazing.
So it's nonstop. It's always something.
It is.
Yeah.
And is it one tractor does it all with you? You got one huge one that you guys seem to.
No, I have a couple that, like, you know, are specialties for each job. The big
literally
one does the tillage work. Yep. I have a smaller one than that does all my planting, and then obviously the sprayer that's maintaining with the fertilizing and all that stuff. But
wow,
we have. I mean, there's more than those ones, but those are the majority of the workhorses of the operation, and I mean.
They've come a long way too now, that equipment.
Oh, yeah. Everything, like the big ones are all like full auto steer and everything.
All
but
GPS and all that.
Everything.
You have to have all that technology to stay, you know, productive because there's no overlapping. Like, you know, every pass is already accounted for in the field. You know exactly how long it's going to take and to the acreage. So I know what to apply for seed and
before
what
you even leave
for fertilizer.
Yeah.
And it's just all. Everything's right down to the last penny figured out already because with the way the input costs are and, you know, just society in general of the price of everything.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a big thing. You can figure out how much something's going to cost to put it in the ground, but you can never really figure out how much it's going to cost to take it out because, I mean, you're really weather reluctant, you know.
And, yeah.
I mean, the boxes, every year they go up 25%.
Literally,
I mean,
right.
Most people don't realize, but just a cabbage box, almost $4 just for the box.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
But there's no inflation right now.
No, it's great. Yeah, you know. You noticed that too.
Yeah.
Okay, I thought it was just my side of the street.
Every year, probably 25% for the last 6 years.
Yeah.
The box has gone up.
Yeah, everything's gone up.
Yeah. When my grandfather started, a box was 5 cents.
Imagine
for
that.
A bushel for a bean box, it
right.
was 5 cents. Now you buy the bean basket, it's probably $12, that little wooden basket.
Yeah, yeah.
And most places don't want you to reuse the boxes because of contamination.
Oh,
anymore.
Absolutely, right. One and done.
And we do the GAP program, which is the Good Agricultural Practices.
Yeah.
So we're certified every year, everything top-notch. We clean everything. Everything's up and on the up and up. And we have to do that in order to sell to like the food chains,
sure.
like Big Y and all those.
Yep.
We have to prove to them that we're doing a good job because they don't want just anybody.
Absolutely.
Just selling to them, you know, because you don't know what's on it and where you eat it. I mean, you should wash everything before you eat it.
Yep.
But, you know.
It's amazing. What people, you know, tomato just grows and I buy it. No.
No, that's not the case. Goes into it.
Literally not. Yeah.
Actually, I've been doing a lot on Facebook and TikTok and Instagram with that. I've been documenting probably this whole season so far on it.
Wonderful. I've seen some of the video we talked and, yeah.
Yep. It's at Calabrese.
Who's running the drone?
I do.
It's nice.
Calabrese Farm. It's at Calabrese Farms on all social media.
Yeah.
So
I'm waiting for the day the drone bounces off the tractor when it's flying around the field.
I just bought one, so I'm getting better
at it. Yeah. There's some of those videos I'm like, okay. Who's the expert here? And that's a talent in itself.
Yeah.
I mean, none of this is easy.
It was too hard standing in front of the tractor and diving out of the way before he ran me over trying to get a video. It was easier to buy a drone.
And he will run
less workman's comp.
Yeah, he will run you over.
I'm more worried about what's happening behind me than in front of me.
Yeah, you can't look both ways. You're not a babysitter.
Yeah.
Yeah. No. Nope.
Surprise. 15 minutes of video breaks down to 30-second video, and it shows people what we're doing.
Yeah.
I mean, where their food comes from, I mean, what goes into it, and
yeah,
people like that. You know, they like to know where their food's coming from, and
it's really coming from town.
Yeah.
You know,
it's local.
It's literally
that's
local.
That's the big thing. It's local.
Yeah.
Who knows? Maybe we'll see a Moolicious video from the drone pretty soon.
Yeah, that's what I'm afraid of.
I'm gonna put a little bucket on it. Come get ice cream.
Well, I laugh because I try to do some of that stuff, and it's a batch freezer, right? So you put the product in, it comes out. There's no excitement there. You got a rim twice the size of him going by him. There's excitement there. You know, there's something that could go wrong.
Nobody wants to watch the ice cream freeze.
Yeah, nobody wants to watch the ice cream
paint
freeze.
Dry, right?
Yeah, yeah, exactly. They like how it looks when it comes out. But
You put a good music video to anything, it'll.
Yeah, I don't know.
Surprised.
Yeah, you would be surprised. It's amazing. And that's what technology is bringing you, right?
Like
you
said. Well, I'm getting ready practicing with the drone because, I mean, I don't know if you've seen out west, they're actually planting or fertilizing, spraying. They're doing all that with drones with now drones. Out west. So right. That's a big thing in agriculture that's coming up.
Your dad's not going to buy you a drone that can do that.
It's actually cheaper than a sprayer.
Oh, is it? Oh, that's scary.
Well, that's the other thing. Like, just in the past 4 years, the price of, like, equipment is probably 30 to 45% higher.
Yeah.
Every year it just climbs another 5 to 10% higher. Yeah. So if you can get, like, the drones where I don't need to be in the actual machine running it, and it's already preset to that field, all you got to basically do is nurse it when it comes back, fill it with product, and send it back out to do that field.
Change the battery
and go.
That's it.
And then you're doing less impact on the crops, too, because you're not driving through
absolutely.
Them where you're
right.
just over the top of them. So it is a next level, like, where it's going to go.
Yeah.
And there's drones that are doing, like, the cover crops now. So we can get a cover crop established in September because you fly over the crop that you're picking. And by the time you're done with it, you already have your cover crop there for the winter.
Done.
And, you know, one step and that's it. So.
Wow. You guys use a gentleman out of Granville that does those manure trucks. So the old days it was hay, manure, right? In the back of a wagon.
Yeah.
You know, that's what I grew up with.
We only use manure on the, like, the commodity stuff.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, we don't use it on anything that we do. For, like, the local produce,
yeah, yeah.
Anything. We don't lettuce, nothing on it that we grow for, that's edible.
Right.
It's only for commodity crops.
Really?
Yeah.
I wouldn't even, you know, I just
that's
pray you never get stuck behind that truck.
Yeah.
You know, that's the biggest thing.
Well, they produce so much because they're milking so many cows, and
yeah.
It's actually a burden. They need to move some of it out of the tanks. So,
gotcha.
Because they have it capped up there, and they're producing energy off of it.
Yes. That's a whole nother.
Yeah, that's
wild in itself. Yeah,
they're tapped back into the grid and they're
and you know,
they're producing energy off of methane gas.
He talked about that for years, right? And yeah. It all finally came together.
Yeah, after everything worked out with the town up there, they weren't really sure of it at first, but yeah, it's working out really good for them up there.
It's nice to see something other than solar panels, you know?
Isn't it?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you guys farm next to solar panels on some of your properties. Yeah, it just sits there, right? What a waste.
Yeah.
It isn't, but.
Like today, I bet they're making a lot of power with it.
Oh, tons.
Rain or
tons.
Wintertime when the snow's sitting on them.
Yeah, yeah.
Or
yeah,
we go by good. The tractor and we put a half inch of dust on them. And
literally, right? And you see that. You know, there's nothing you can do about it. You're doing your deal.
Well,
and
they knew when they put them there.
Yep.
It doesn't make sense. Why don't I go build them on the side of a mountain instead of prime farmland.
And,
you know,
yeah.
Right there in town, but. Whatever, to each their own.
Yep, to each their own, absolutely.
The price is right. I wouldn't blame the guy for doing it either.
Well, and that's what you're coming, you know, let's face it. Your family's fortunate you two kids stayed around and are doing it. And neither of you, from what I can see, are extremely wealthy at all. You farm that land. You guys work 85, 90 hours a week. It's at the point where I don't think it's the money. Because it isn't.
It's a life. It's a life.
It's a life. Literally a life.
You just say it's. You just keep going with it.
At one point, Mikey went through a truck a year. Remember those days? You know, you've come a long way, Michael. You really have. But it just, like you say, it's a way of life. So
insurance is a wonderful thing.
I don't know. I'm sure your dad's shaking his head sometimes, or at least your poor mom. But yeah, you guys. But you're right. It's a farming life. There's no.
I mean, it's like the same thing every day, but on a year-round schedule.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, I mean, you know what you're doing and stuff like that. And, I mean, it's the whole family's involved. My mom, my sister.
Yep,
they
literally.
Run the store. They do all the greenhouses, the flowers. They take care of all that. We do everything else with my dad outside. I mean, all the maintenance, all the greenhouse repairs, all the planting, all that stuff is. So, I mean, it's a real family affair. I mean, we even got a cousin in the mix.
Yes. Yes, you do. Yeah. And it just, you know, from the outside looking in, you're fortunate. You do have a family that you know, I see it continuing on. But we look around at other farms.
Well, if there's no
if there's
next generation, then
it's, yeah.
Yeah.
You know.
It's not a very, like a.
No, it's not. it's not appreciated at all.
Yeah.
None of this is.
That is not very intriguing. Hey, I want to go become a farmer.
Yeah. Yeah. Do I get my 6 weeks vacation? Yeah. Where's my 401k? Yeah, where is that? Yeah. Yeah. Oh, I got to get my break. Is it time for a break at 10 o'clock? I'm sure you pull that tractor right over on the side of the road and take your 15-minute break.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Sometimes I just park it in a road. Hey?
Yeah.
Nice, nice, sun, nice shady spot.
Yeah, it's nice shady spot. Yeah. Yeah. Get your lunchtime. I'm sure someone runs out with your hot lunch for you. Yeah. Yeah. No.
You think Joe Didi would start delivering to the field?
You would think.
Maybe on Grubhub or something.
Yeah, well, I'm going to get a drone.
I got to get a drone. There you go.
There we go.
Ball, full circle.
Your coordinates
put in. A little landing pad on top of a roof. You can land right there.
Yeah, here's your sandwich, kid. Keep working. Wow. So that you're right. You guys have a decent-sized family. And then there's two little ones I see running around?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Soon to be three, I hear?
Yeah.
Yeah, I got one coming, too.
Wow. That's – I.
Well, help's getting harder to find, you know.
It's easier
to produce it.
I got two little grandchildren. Trust me, I'm laughing. Artie, you're going to be making ice cream. Madison, you'll be the front end. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it's just one of them, Benny, he's getting a little bit older. So he's like driving around now in the fields and stuff.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yeah.
And Mikey, you seem to work a lot with Benny, it seems, or at least
he's
your little buddy.
Got him riding a bike finally and all that stuff. Yep. Yeah, he rides around with us. He loves riding around the tractor.
Oh, I bet. Anyone would.
And I take him on deliveries every now and then.
Nice.
You know, he loves it.
That's awesome. Yeah.
It's something.
It is.
Yeah.
It is. It really is. And you'll close
Halloween.
Columbus Day? Halloween?
Halloween.
Yeah. Well, it depends if... depends on the weather. If we get frosted out early in October, there's no fence, so it'll be like around the 15th or something. But if it's still really good, we're picking, you know, a lot of stuff out of the field, we'll go right to Halloween.
We do like the Halloween decorations too and all that stuff, and you do
a great job.
We do about, I don't know, 5,500, 6,000 mums.
And that was
so when the last mum is sold, that's when my mom goes on vacation. She takes a break.
Finally. Yeah, she doesn't come out of her house. That's all. I wouldn't call it a vacation.
She's definitely the hardest working one. I can tell you that.
She does a great job.
She even locks the door so no one can go bother her.
Imagine that.
To put a doggy door instead of grandchildren.
Yeah, grandchildren and the dogs. There's quite a few little pups running around. Is there a new one over there?
Yeah, I just got another one.
You did?
Yeah.
We were trying to figure out who. Okay.
Yeah. There was a free dog, but it's getting expensive. He broke his leg.
I saw that.
Yeah. He jumped up and just landed on it wrong, and he's an animal. Just going crazy, running into walls and lazumis, they call it, when he just runs around in circles and
oh boy,
put a tooth through his jaw.
So,
vet bills are getting there, but luckily we got the insurance on him, so
that's good.
Not too bad. Just co-pays for now.
Yeah. Sounds like a child. Oh, I'm sorry. That's coming. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
That is coming.
And then there's my other one. They're both Australian cattle dogs.
They are, okay. Yeah,
Piper. She's the one you can see if anybody goes to the store, my mom's shadow.
Yes,
and she follows around. We're always within 2 feet of her, just constantly going. So I pick her up in the morning, let her open the door, and she runs out into the store and finds my mom. And
that's it.
Stays with her all day long.
That's something.
Yeah. It is. It is something. That's why I'm trying to get the other one to do it. So
In time.
That's it.
It'll all come around.
It's easier than watching the dog all day.
Oh, no, It is. So corn and pumpkins really your number one stuff?
Eggplant? They're the most.
I mean, Roma close, so I don't know how the eggplant's going to go anymore.
No, they're the most acre, generally the most acres we most plant. Volume. But, I mean, we grow a lot of green bell peppers, hot peppers, the tomato crop. Those are two of the major crops, too. And then there's obviously summer squash year-round, zucchini, eggplant. But the biggest acreage is the sweet corn and pumpkins.
And it is sweet corn?
Yes.
It usually comes out. I mean, when I was a little younger, I could listen to who was going to be the first one in town with corn. Does that still exist?
That's guaranteed me anyway.
No, I don't. But I can remember that. It's crazy.
Yeah. I mean, in order to get corn for 4th of July,
it's obviously a lot
more of an expense because we have to cover it to warm it up faster so it has cloth over it, and then you're always constantly watching the cloth, make sure like the wind comes up and rip the cloth. Next thing you know, you're out there replacing a piece or fixing it.
So yeah, take me through that. I see cloth, sometimes I see plastic. What are you doing out there?
So usually, generally with the corn, I'll go in and we'll plant it, and as soon as we're done planting it, we'll add the cloth over the top of it, and that cloth is anywhere from 5 to 8 degrees warmer the soil, warming the soil up faster. So you're obviously getting a...
And it is cloth. It's like the old tobacco cloth.
Yeah, it's called floating cloth. So when the corn, the bigger the corn gets, it stretches with it.
Really?
Because I won't take that off till almost June 1st. The longer I keep it on, it's creating a greenhouse effect in theory under there. But it's stretching as the corn's lifting it. And then once, you know, right when we start to get like a pre-tassel in it, that's when we remove the cloth off of it. And I mean, that'll speed it up anywhere from 10 to 15 days.
Wow.
If I just went out and planted that seed and didn't cover it. So that's a big thing.
Is that removed by hand, by machine?
Yeah, we have to lay it out by hand.
And pick it up by hand.
But then you'll see the plastic is more, we're using plastic now for weed control.
Yeah.
And the biggest thing is now none of the produce is actually touching the soil. Everything is raised on the plastic, like summer squash and stuff that you're just going to consume like that. It's all sitting on plastic, so nothing's touching the soil, and they're just
I never knew that.
Yeah. And it's watered from underground too. It's watered with drip tape underneath.
We're never overhead watering where you could take the chance of spreading a disease like an airborne or something like that. We're only directly feeding to the root where we're minimizing how much water too. Because we can cut back almost 80% of how much water if we were doing it overhead with a big sprinkler.
And all that water is filtered. It goes through three big sand filters. So it's all good, clean water.
How much labor goes into a squash? You just put me through quite a bit of labor.
Well, the whole thing with the plastic is it's all one-pass machine. Like, I'm applying your fertilizer, the plastic, and all the drip. So the biggest labor part of it is actually when it comes time to hook up all the ones underneath there.
Right.
That's the biggest part of that. And then from there on, it's just go on and start a pump, and it'll automatically feed it, whether we run it for 6-8 hours. But it's the amount of water that we reduce by using just feeding the root.
Oh, absolutely.
Instead of actually watering the whole plant.
Yeah, right.
It's usually about, like, we break everything up into sections because the pump can only handle so many sections, so we'll water, you know, two sections of squash.
Sure.
And then we'll water the other two. So we start usually around like 7 o'clock in the morning watering. And I mean, depending on if it's dry out, we can go 24 hours with it.
Absolutely.
I mean, I usually shut sprinklers down at like midnight or something like that just to get going, and then he'll go start them the next morning. And it's just like teamwork, you know?
Yeah.
Just keep going with it. I mean, it's hard to keep up with it 24 hours. And then my dad will drive around filling them up.
Right.
And just keep going with it. I mean, like last year it was all drought and then it got too much rain. So I mean,
you can't
get a happy medium. It's right. Either one or the other.
Last year we wish we could have turned them on reverse and sucked the water out of the field.
That's the problem. You can't take the water. You can put the water down, but you can't take it away.
And like on a normal year, I'd rather have it be on the drier side because like we can apply the water.
Right.
Last year it was a disaster. It was just,
you start getting phytophthorus and everything. It's just
6 inches of rain at a time, and you know everything looks beautiful, and then you come back the next day, you just want to chop it all up because the rain just pulverizes everything. And then being with that plastic that we do that you'll see by the school and everything when you guys drive by, that is elevating the plant too. So we're almost anywhere from, you know, 8 to 12 inches above the actual floor of the soil. So that's keeping air flowing through in between the plants, and it's raised so that, like I said, that squash is not sitting in water now. It's sitting on black plastic where it's going to dry out a lot faster, and there was no contamination, and it brings everything in cleaner out of the field.
Absolutely.
Where then we run it through our packing lines, which are, you know, sanitized every day.
Yep.
And all stainless,
all stainless. So I mean, I literally take it off the packing line, I'll eat it. That's how confident I am on it.
Oh, absolutely.
With our stuff, because it's going through brushes and water.
But from the road, you see none of this. You know, going by the high school, going by powder mill.
Oh, if you're in the store, you can hear the machine running.
No, you can in the back.
You see the wagons,
but
you get behind the wagon going two miles an hour.
Yeah, of course.
Or you occasionally see some summer squash in the road that fell off the trailer coming through town.
Yeah,
I think one of the help dropped a bin of peppers last year. It fell right off the road, right in there. About 15 minutes to clean up. The cars are backing up.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's all part of it.
The worst is when they paved the road over there on 57 all the way through the center of town. We put everything, we pick it in baskets or bins.
Right.
We put it on a trailer. And when the road was being paved, it was just unbelievably bouncy. Everything was falling off.
Well, you got a mile and a half now of hell.
That whole year we had to do something different.
Between the tea house and us, you're going to have some fun this summer.
Oh, it's brutal on the equipment and stuff, too.
It is.
I got to slow down so much, and, you know, cars don't know what's going on.
And you're not going fast as it is.
I change a wagon wheel probably every other day. It's just
really
always popping tires on it and stuff. Oh. Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, too bad you don't know an elected official.
Southwick's not known for their best roads.
No, well, we used to be, apparently.
Yeah.
Yeah, not anymore.
Yeah. Well, even like Foster Road, I mean, that road's, it's rough. And I mean, you got to take your time, and it's not my fault. I mean, I can go as fast as I can go with the road. I mean, you break a wheel off or something.
Axles, then you gotta, all sorts of
then
stuff.
Then you got a really big problem.
Yes, you do. Yeah, the equipment doesn't move easily.
No.
No.
Then you got to contend with the, you know, traffic is in a rush. If it was an ambulance, they pull over. But when this thing coming down the road, they try to pass you
as
close as they can.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I've heard about, you know, the poor cowards, you know, every time they turn around, someone's hitting the tractor.
Yeah, you take out a Tesla every now and then. It's not too bad.
Tesla, there you go. As long as it doesn't catch on fire, then you'll be all done. So all that product you use to make the squash, the plastic, the drip, any of that reusable, or is it a one and done?
No, yeah, it's more of a one and done.
Wow.
I mean,
sanitary reasons, you can't.
No, understood, but you look at the price of a squash,
and
you don't realize the back side of that squash, how much money is invested before gets
to
the box, $2 on that too. Yeah.
Yeah. But your labor, your that.
Oh, the input cost.
Exactly.
I mean, if you thought, like, you saw how much the input cost was, you'd be like, why do they even bother wasting their time?
Right. And then they bring them back and we put them in a big tub. We wash everything. And then you have to have two or three people hand cleaning it, packing it, and then sending it out. And then, you know, and the worst part is if it rained out the day before, squash gets scratched up because the leaves and the vines on the leaves are like prickly.
Okay.
So if you get a hard rain, it squashes up the plant. So you got a beautiful looking squash, but it's got a couple scratches on it. Well, that's not sellable anymore because now it's scratched and it'll start getting brown where the scratch was.
Oh, okay.
But it's the same thing. So you got to go through that. I mean, you could have a good crop, but you could throw a lot away too.
Yeah. Before you even get back to the store.
It's all based on the appearances of it. Yeah.
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 Oh, like, we'll get stuff that's not marketable for the chains and stuff. And, like, you know, my mom or dad will bring you over stuff to the food pantry. Oh,
me and strawberries are wonderful.
Well, even to the food pantry.
But the food pantry is great. I see
she was your best friend, I think, right, last year?
The last few years.
Yeah.
You know? The girls hate you. Yeah. They see your dad pull up in the morning like, are you kidding me?
They got to load the truck and everything for them, huh?
Yeah, yeah. It's, you know, we have bread racks for bread, of course, but your strawberries end up on them.
Yep.
And if it's a rainy day, they're slicing and slicing and slicing.
Good thing you don't have a loading dock. There'd be a 53-footer backed in there.
Your strawberries I get all the way through the season and literally into the spring with them.
Well, that's the thing with strawberries. They're fresh. A fresh strawberry, like in the supermarket, shouldn't last a week, two weeks. A fresh strawberry only lasts one day, so we'll go out and pick it at 7 in the morning. It'll be in the store. Somebody will come in and buy it and eat it that night. It's not made to
It literally
is overnight.
Right.
So that's why we take the bad stuff.
Yeah.
The older stuff, we give it to you, and it's perfect
morning
for ice cream. It's perfect for chopping up.
We chop it and freeze it.
Freeze it. Perfect.
Freeze it. Yeah. I'll freeze 800-900 pounds of your strawberries.
But after 24 hours, fresh strawberries start to break down.
Right.
So that's, you know, a lot of the stuff you've seen supermarket, people don't realize that, you know.
Yes, no, they
produce isn't supposed to make
the
last.
We don't need to look at that. the people we are today isn't the people you guys were as kids, so none of that matters. Like you say, the squash has to be pretty. You know, it's
that's
a consumable.
The thing, like the big chains, like not the chains, but the big commercial farms like that are growing producers where, you know, they're hybrids to be able to ship it from California to the East Coast or something where, like, literally, the morning we're picking, you're buying in an hour from then.
Literally.
And probably having it for that dinner.
Right.
And it's the freshest. I mean, it was literally on a vine growing at 7 in the morning that morning. Now you're, you know, cutting it up for your dinner.
Yeah. Well, I'll watch in the morning. The corn comes in early.
Yep.
And it's gone, you know.
And all the places we sell to, they like that too.
Absolutely.
Like, I mean, that's one of the biggest things, like, we sell to, like, the big Y. It's fresh every day when we pick it. And then they ship it out to their stores fresh. Well,
yeah.
I mean, that's the whole name of the game.
It is.
Fresh local produce.
Fresh local produce.
Yep. And it's the best thing for you.
It is. Yeah.
Well, with even like you just said with the sweet corn, you're never buying old sweet corn.
It's never.
Four hours at a time. It's in our stand and it's fresh. Even to the rest of our customers, they're buying every day. So you're getting a freshly picked ear of corn. Like, I mean, you can't get any fresher unless you grew it in your garden and walked off the back porch to go pick it.
But they're too lazy to pick it by then.
And sometimes we sell out. That's the thing. We sell out by noon.
Yeah.
We have to go pick more.
Literally,
You know, if you buy it in the afternoon, the fresh corn, that's actually probably only an hour old, even though it was picked
Yep.
You know what I mean?
I usually go about 3:30.
Delta, yeah.
Yeah, and it's the new, right, you're right, they're just coming, yep. The trailers are just coming in again.
Because we aim to sell everything that day.
Yes.
We don't want anything to hold over to the next day. Everything, so we try to time it right with everything and make it work.
It has to
That's
work.
It.
I don't know if you've ever been in a cornfield in the afternoon, but it's,
haven't been invited.
It's the most miserable place you could possibly be.
Worse than tobacco?
Oh, it's way worse.
Really?
It's stagnant humidity air floating. You can like taste it as you
itchy,
breathe.
Itchy, everything.
The air is pollen.
No.
And then in the mornings when we go out there, you got to wear rain gear.
I see that. Yeah, the guys all have rain gear.
The morning dew on your grass.
Right.
Now it's 8 feet tall and you're walking through and you're soaked.
So you don't have to shower in the mornings. Okay.
Oh. Wow. But it's a lot easier to pick it first thing in the morning when it's crisp like that. It snaps off the plant more. Where if you get into the afternoon, it's harder to break it off the plant because, you know, you're getting a little bit of wilt down from the humidity in the day.
Gotcha.
More elastic, so it's kind of hard to snap
literally,
off.
Yeah.
It's like trying to pull a piece of tape apart. So that's the majority of why we pick it. But, some days we have to pick, you know, like you said, a couple times a day. So.
Yep.
And it's all hand-picked, too. I mean, we tried.
I was just going to ask that.
We tried picking with a machine before, but the problem is with a machine, it takes everything, and you can only pick that field once. So if we're by hand picking, we're going through the field, and if we come across an unripe ear, you leave it, and then we'll circle back the next couple of days and get that ear. So we're getting 100% or
out of
probably 95% out of a field by hand picking it, when you would probably only get 60-70% by machine picking, and you'd be a lot more waste.
And so the certain part of that corn's ready today. Within probably 5-6 days, you're done with that field.
Yeah.
As you make your passes?
He rotates it for that purpose.
That's the thing is, like, that's why we have to have enough so we can make sure we shoot for 100% right. It obviously takes more time and money to go back and have to pick again, and you're not pulling as much per time. So that's why we plant a little bit more so that we're always chasing it. And, you know, if we can pick ear for ear, because obviously that's the fastest way. So,
but that whole stock, then they're not all ripe at the same time.
For the most part, they are. Early season, like the first stuff we start picking,
no,
the weather played such a factor. But now, like everything from mid-July throughout the season, as long as weather didn't mess it up or it got grounded out or something.
Too dry
That it should be almost ear for ear on there.
Wow.
So that was like last year by the schools over there. We picked corn first there. And then I had replanted it. You don't even know how many people asked me. They're like, oh, I didn't know corn regrew itself.
Isn't that something?
Yeah. Because we went in, we picked it first. And then we went and I went and replanted it again so we could reuse the land again. And people were like, oh, so it grows back every year? I'm like, yeah.
It sure does. Yeah. Yeah. Buy some for the house. Do we change fields? Does a field have to rest year to year?
No, not necessarily. But I do a lot of soil samples, so we know what's there. So it's good to rotate crop, because each one, you know, sometimes it takes a little bit more of some mineral or nutrient out of the soil. So you rotate it and try to keep everything consistent. And the biggest, like pumpkins, you don't want to grow year after year.
Okay.
Because of like last year was so much phytophthora and bacteria out there and having such a mild winter. Where if we don't get like a good frost, like a frost in the ground and a snowpack, it doesn't disinfect the soil. Like where if you had 3 feet of frost, it killed everything in that soil.
Sterilizes the soil every year.
Then you don't have to worry. But last year, I don't even think we even had 2 inches of frost. So all that disease, like from the pumpkins, like people know they must have went to stores and bought pumpkins. They rotted a week later.
Yes, I saw that.
Was the plant was already sick, but it looked good. As soon as you cut it off, now it started breaking down. So that stuff is still in your soils. So if you went into it again this year, and even if it wasn't a wet year, it takes one little rainstorm like this to kickstart it all again.
Activates it right up.
And now you're back into the same situation.
Gotcha.
So that's why it's a rotation. Like I already know like what's going to be planted at where before I even start. So I have it all planned out. And then like even looking forward to next year, like I already know like, all right, so we're going to plant this here next year. So I already have it prepped. So I don't even have to do it next year. So it's just like a schedule and rotation.
You know what cover crop to put down. The cover crop helps too. It puts more nutrients into the ground and all that stuff too. So when you disc that in. And
strawberries, though, that comes back every year?
Yes. We usually go 2 to 3 years on a spot. Field. Like right now, like start yesterday, we're planting next year's strawberry crop.
Really?
Yeah.
We're doing something different this year, though. This is the first year we're putting them on plastic.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, usually
we'll see what happens.
Yeah. It's a little different, but it's hard to get the year, probably 3 years out of it. You might get two because the runners have a hard place to go. So we're using biodegradable plastic.
Okay.
So it'll keep the weeds off. We're planting them. It'll keep the weeds off them all year.
To get it going. Right, yep. Right.
And then yeah. Probably by November, the plastic will break down. It's right. All up and up, biodegradable.
Yeah, yeah. No, absolutely.
And then we'll put the straw on it, winter over, and yeah. Then next year all those runnels will start taking off and stuff. I mean, the plastic will be all gone.
Yeah.
So.
And you hopefully have a stronger plant.
Yeah.
That's the theory, right?
Well, and the other thing is, too, with the strawberries, like a mild winter hurts them. You know, they'd rather have the snow over them insulating.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
And by, you know, taking the brunt of all the wind and rain over the winter time, where if they had a blanket of snow, they're insulated.
Right.
And it helps with new growth in the springtime because you get a lot of winter kill by the plant just being exposed out there.
They're like a bear. They like to hibernate.
Yeah, and be tucked in. That's why you'll see straw overall. Like
so I see Mikey on his knees tucking all the strawberries yeah, every in night, yeah. Every night.
Singing them lullaby.
I'm just going to say that, yeah. Little song, you know. Yeah.
Petting them.
Got them named out there.
Yeah.
Hey, whatever. I get the benefits out of it, so it's all good. You know, I'll help you. Tell me what field you're at. Wow.
You want to get paid by the basket or by the hour?
That's a great. No, I'm heavy and fat, so I'm gonna go by the hour.
That's what yeah. I figured. You were
yeah, those days are gone. Tobacco only lasted a week.
I don't see you running across the field to grab the next flat.
No, you don't. You don't. No. Maybe one of the grandkids, but not me. Start them
coming out with red fingers and everything from eating them all, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. What? Yeah. That's why it's by the hour.
Yeah. Yeah. You got to weigh you when you come in, weigh you when you come out. That's
there
how
you go. That's how we the
used,
food pantry.
That's how we used to pick. That's how we used to pick your own, right?
Right. Oh, that's funny. Yeah. Yeah. You both get weighed to strawberries. Yeah. That's something. Well, it's been a lot of fun. What's the best thing you like about Southwick? Like you both decided to live here. You didn't move out into Westfield or Agawam. What's the best? And the next question will be, what's the worst? So what's?
It's a small community. I mean, you know everybody, and
yeah.
I mean, everyone's pretty laid back, and you know, accepts the you know like the farming and deals with the tractors.
Right.
I mean,
it is what it is.
Yeah, I mean. Been my home for my whole life, so yeah. I mean, I know like everybody, and so that's more of the thing is like you know your
neighbor. Are those tractors going to go electric someday?
No,
no. They say that with the police cruisers. Oh, we're going to get a hybrid. I'm like, why? You know, I just so I don't get
so,
it.
So when they run out of battery, you can get away from them.
Yeah,
yeah. The thing is, they're not.
Mike, you never had that problem. You always got away from them.
Well, the thing is, I mean, a battery can only last what 6 hours. What do you do?
Sure.
14-hour day.
Right. Home. No, absolutely.
I mean, I kind of like that idea, but I don't think it'll work out at the end of the day.
No. So, no, it's going to.
I mean, if they make some huge improvements, who knows where the future brings. I like
Well, the drone, like you said, though, that's your future.
Oh, and then they even got self-driving tractors now. I kind of like that.
Yeah. Boy, you're putting you right out of a job.
Man, I can sit at home on the couch and just run them on the TV.
I just don't see you sitting, neither of you actually sitting home on a couch. I'm sorry.
Or on a beach. That even sounds better. Oh, yeah.
That I can relate to. Michael, what do you love about Southwick?
It's just a small town.
Yeah.
They, you know, it's just everybody knows everybody.
They
everybody
do.
Helps everybody if you ever have any issues. Like, we're neighbors.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Know, we borrow your forklift. You borrow ours.
And well, you guys have a nice one. Now you won't let me borrow it. But, yeah.
I mean, everybody.
We got now now it comes here. With a driver.
Everybody helps everybody. They, yeah. You know, I mean,
oh, I love that. Trust everybody. Me. Yeah.
It's.
Yeah. If
it's,
I'm out of
you
town,
don't get that in a
your
big
dad plows, thing. You guys plow me out.
Yeah. I plowed you out the chair. Yeah.
And if I, same thing, if your sister, you know, I'd make a pat. Your dad's like, well, don't go too far. I'm sure he doesn't want me to wreck anything.
Yeah. Hey, the next time you do that, don't leave the snowbanks in the middle of the driveway to freeze.
Yeah. See, there you go. See, I'm already screwing up.
I had to push those out when I got there.
And you did a great job. They just wanted to make sure you kept doing something in the winter.
Oh, that's appreciate it.
So what do you hate about Southwick? Not hate. What are you disappointed in? How's that? The hunting bylaw squashed, so that's good.
Yeah.
You don't have to worry about that.
The only other thing is everyone needs to know everyone's business, I guess.
They do. You're absolutely right about that.
You go on social media. Why is this?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the
biggest. Keyboard warriors. It's sad that we're at that state of life. Luckily, I only got a few years left and I'm gone, but you guys have some time left to deal with that whole mess. And it is.
What are we moving to Florida permanently?
No, well, I'm moving somewhere permanently. Ain't Florida. Yeah, but you're right. Social media, unfortunately, drives a lot of headaches.
Yeah, it's just everyone needs to know everyone's business. And
they do.
I don't care what you're doing. You shouldn't care what I'm doing.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, if it doesn't affect your neighbor,
it's
good, you know.
Yeah, but it is what it is. That's the way we're living.
No, it is. It truly is. Yeah, no doubt about it. Michael, what do you think?
Same thing what he said, pretty much. Yeah. I think we can all agree on that.
Yeah, that's unfortunate. But and they, you know.
I mean, it's a small town. Everybody knows your business. So
they've known it for 100 years, right? We didn't need social media. You learned it at Miss Murphy's, and you learned it at the breakfast places.
Yeah, Miss Murphy's used to be like.
Oh, my God. Yeah, thank God they did away with the seating inside, or most of it. Because you're right. You knew by 7 a.m., you knew the whole town's business. That's whether you wanted to or not.
They close up their doors. The old timers in town didn't know what to do.
Literally. Yeah.
The old watering hole.
Yep. But it worked.
Well,
right?
No, but now we got Moolicious. That's a new watering hole.
No, and it's
we
not go there. And well, I do tend to see your father there with some other old gentlemen, but it's usually a milkshake at 4 or 5. And the stories are horrendous. And it's amongst themselves.
The meeting of the minds over there.
Yeah, they beat up on each other, you know?
Absolutely.
But hey, it's all good. Well, guys,
what do you love about Southwick?
The town. You're right. I moved here in 74. We bought a farm up on End of Klein Road. Take a left. So is that South Loomis or North Loomis? I still screw that up.
I still get that messed up.
South Loomis.
South Loomis. Yeah. So Shaughnessy's had a farm up there of some sort. Mother on her second marriage bought it at auction. So it was either 12 or 24 acres. You know, there's 7 of us in the family, plus always a grandmother or two or a cousin or someone that needed a place to stay. You didn't name the animals. You got off the bus. You weeded the tomato plants. You know, literally we grew up pigs, everything. We slaughtered and canned stuff and froze stuff, and that was your winter product. I'm not – you guys are gun guys. I can remember walking my niece and nephew in the late fall through your property. Your dad would say, we're going to New Hampshire, okay, or wherever you guys have a place. You know, and I'd look around, and you got deer hanging in the back. News to me, you know what I mean? I'm not a hunter. I shot a gun at, I think, 8 years old, and we were spinning pellets out of squash all winter. Because I'm not that guy. I've never been that guy.
A lot of chipped teeth, huh?
A lot of chipped teeth, yeah, literally, you know. And then when you killed the cows on property, the guy would stay for the weekend that slaughtered them. And my stepfather, a fresh heart, fresh liver. Unbelievable.
Yeah.
You know, it was a lot of ketchup in that household. A lot of ketchup. So yeah, I grew up there, enjoyed it for sure.
Times have changed.
They have changed. I was fortunate to move out. That's always the scary part. The tumble in was the tumble in back then. And, you know, the kids either lived on that bar stool and never left town, or they did leave town.
Yeah.
I was fortunate.
When did that close? 90s?
Boy, I don't even know. Yeah. Yeah, I would think the 90s. Yeah, and its heyday, it was rocking.
Yeah,
you know, I worked at Shabelli's Mobile as a kid, towing cars. I think I just got my permit or my license, and that place was hopping way back then.
You didn't even need one of those back then.
I didn't want to say that. I didn't want to go there. But you're right. You know,
times have changed.
Literally have changed. And I guess for the good or for the worse, it is what it
in
is.
In some ways, yeah. In some ways, no.
No, you're absolutely right. So, yeah, that's where I grew up. What do I hate? I guess I hate the social media, the politics, all the BS that's there. There's too many people in that town that try to do the right thing and then just get destroyed by keyboard warriors. And that's what I call them. You guys see it. You're going to have 10 million likes on your sweet corn today, but they didn't come to the store. You know what I mean? My stuff for ice cream, you know, say 3,000 likes. Well, I didn't get 3,000 customers today. You know, fireworks, right? We want fireworks. So I get 10,000 likes. If each resident gave me $1, we could do fireworks. No, not going to happen. So, yeah, it is what it is.
It's easier to hit the like button.
Yeah, isn't it? It just is. It is. And you know what? It's a great town. I'm not going to leave anytime soon on my own accord. And it sounds like you boys will be around for a little while. So congratulations on your the next vision of Little Calabrese's.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Girl or boy, do you know?
Girl.
You're going to get tortured. Oh, July. Okay, beautiful. I think my son's due, I think, in August. August 8th or something. I got another one.
Oh, nice.
My mom needs more help in the store. So.
No, absolutely.
That'll work good.
And you're not as old as me, but I kind of look back now and chuckle because I got grandchildren that are going to grow up in this town. You guys, you have a child coming, your sister. So, you know, it's just another version, right? Here they all go again, you know? But they won't be driving. They'll be driving electric snowmobiles by then, I'm sure. They won't be.
It's a big circle. That's all it is.
It really is.
Not if I can help it.
Not if you can help it. All right, guys, we're done. It's 9:01. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you soon.
All right. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.